Thank you for tuning in to TalkWad.com, the world's fastest growing internet radio network. Please check out all the other great shows on www.talkwad.com. Whoa, whoa.
Welcome to the Empowerment Hour, and I'm your host, T. Caseman. Looking forward to talking to you and not at you. This is our second voyage on the maiden ship, and we look forward to this journey with you where our guests, our call-in guests, and our audience talk about today's most controversial issues. On the Empowerment Hour, we actually add a empowerment perspective to context and social and dynamic issues in your daily life. And we add resources with an overdrop of clinical information that you can use to help you through your life journey. The last show will mimic this show. We started off with an intro and a quarter today. And we have this special thing here on the show where we talk about the elephant in the room. And the elephant in the room is simply a problem that you may be facing that no one ever really talks about. But on this show, we will talk about it. We will discuss it, and we will get into some dynamic issues. And hopefully you can add to the conversation. But the overdrop is that we will add an empowerment perspective to your social issues. We will give you a quarter of the day. We will talk about social scenarios that you may be facing and talk about our hot topic today. You got to be curious. I hope you're joining in because this is a hot topic to talk about. Most people don't like sharing their views, so if you want to call in, you can call in to the Empowerment Hour show at 813-235-0644, and I'm your host, T. Caseman. Well, let's get started. Today's quote is by Maya Angelou. I would like to read you some inspiring words from Ms. Angelou, and here we go. I learned that no matter what happens or how bad it seems today, life does go on, and it will be better tomorrow. I've learned that you can tell a lot about a person by the way he or she handles these three things: a rainy day, lost luggage, a tangled Christmas tree lights. I've learned that regardless of your relationship with your parents, you've missed them when they're gone from your life. I learned that making a living is not the same thing as making a life. I've learned that life is sometimes gives you a second chance. I've learned that you shouldn't go through life with a catcher's mitt on both hands. You need to be able to throw something back. I learned that whenever I decide something with an open heart, I usually make the right decision. I learned that even when I have pains, I don't have to be one. I've learned that every day you should reach out and touch someone. People love a warm hug or just a friendly pat on the back. I've learned that I still have a lot to learn. I learned that people will forget what you said. People will forget what you do. But people will never forget how you made them feel. And this is the quote of the day by Maya Angelou. And I hope that you can reference this empowerment quote in your daily life and meditate on it, that it may take you to a whole nother level of intellect and motivation in your daily walk. Our next agenda on the show is to talk about that elephant in the room. Many of you say, what is the elephant in the room? We talked about it earlier. You said, T. Caseman, what do you mean the elephant in the room? Well, I'll tell you. The elephant in the room is something that you do not want to talk about. Culturally, it may be something, a stigma. It may be something within your family that pretty much been swept under the rug for a while, and no one ever gave you the opportunity to express your views or your feelings, your grief, to be able to deal with those situations. Let's take some social scenarios, and then we'll get to the main point of our show, our guiding light of this main voyage. What if your social scenario surrounds you lost your job? What if one day you went to work and you received a pink slip in the mail, in your mailbox, that you are no longer needed at your job? Now, you have a mortgage, you have a car note, you have kids in college, you have a wife, you might even have a newborn baby on the way. How would you feel? What are the emotions that you may be going through? And who would you even talk to? Now, one thing about this show, T. Caseman want to reiterate that we match need to resources, as we do with social work, one-on-one. Now, even though we give a clinical feel about a lot of the emotional issues you go through and psychological issues, you must always follow up with your healthcare physician, or your psychiatrist for further evaluation. So this is just an overview. But our social scenario surrounds a lot of different situations that affect everyday individuals, everyday families, through their daily walk. Let's talk about if a social scenario surrounds your mate or significant other may be dispatched to Iraq or some part of the world where war is going on. He's in the military, and you get the news that you're going to be deployed in 2 weeks to go to a war zone. How would you feel? Would your stress level rise? How would you feel if you was facing a medical issue that the doctor gave you? The doctor diagnosed you with some sort of critical illness, and you had to go back to the doctor to find out the final results after waiting 2 weeks. How would you feel? See, these are all scenarios that the everyday individual go through. And many of us do not talk about these things. Many of us do not share our views and our opinions, even our worst fears, with our friends or family members because we're scared of the feedback that we may receive. And how many of us receive professional help whenever we do find ourselves in this situation? Let's take another social scenario. Let's take a wife, a family that been married for 15 years, and she found out that her husband left her. He just left you for another person. And you have to raise 3 kids by yourself. You have a mortgage. You have health care that you wasn't in charge of. Your child is sick. And you don't know how in the world you're going to pay your next mortgage payment. Let's take another social scenario. Let's say that you lost your job and you can't afford your car note. And your only means of transportation in your area is that one vehicle. And you need your job. How would you feel? What if you're a college student and you're close to graduate and your last semester, you have 1 semester before you graduate and you exhaust your financial aid? And you do not come from a well-to-do family where, you know, you come from a high socioeconomic status where you could pay for college classes, you may have to leave college and find yourself getting a job. How would you feel? What if one of your mate or your loved one get Baker acted, have a psychosis moment, break down and has to get Baker acted? What are the steps you take? What are the things that you go through? These are our social scenarios that we talk about on this show. And what leads us up to the moment is general anxiety. We say, anxiety. Everyone has anxiety. You know, how do you tell when you're suffering from a disorder or you're suffering from daily life stressors? Can anyone ask you, you say, well, T.K. Smith, when do mental health issues start and when does it end? When do I know I have an issue? You may can't sleep, you may can't work, you may can't concentrate, you might lose your appetite, and every day seems to be a daily struggle. So let's talk about anxiety disorder, because these are normal day-to-day stresses that add up to people's lives, which make the daily walk difficult. Let's find out what the definition of general anxiety is, okay? Now, as far as the diagnostic statistical manual, which is used by most, really all healthcare or mental health practitioners, and we want you to follow up with any diagnosis you or any information that you get out this show, because this show is just a reference to mental health for you to say to yourself, maybe I might be dealing with a few issues. And T. Caseman has enlightened me about some things that I need to follow up with my psychiatrist or seek counseling or even family therapy to help me manage my mental health. Because mental health is just as important as physical health. So from the Statistical Diagnostic Manual, number 4, the revision, general anxiety disorder, it's categorized by those that are in assessment field, 300.02. And now, you can tell the difference about general anxiety, because general anxiety has indicators, as most healthcare professionals or mental health professionals like to say, that leads up really symptoms that really leads up to a diagnosis. So we're talking about indicators right now, okay? When you experience excessive anxiety and worry, well, you might say, T. Caseman, man, I'm worried every day. I mean, hey, I go to work. I'm worried about losing my job. I'm worried about my kids every day. I'm worried about how I'm going to provide for my family in this hard economic time. But let's talk about what's the difference between a general worry, a generalized stress, and this is the defined line. When excessive anxiety and worry occur more days than not for at least 6 months, that is a substantial amount of time. And it's about a certain event. It could be a number of events in your life that's going on. It could be work-related. It could be school-related. It could be relationships-related. But that 6 months is a good indicator. Everyday worry, stress continually, that I may need to seek mental health treatment. Let's continue out of the Diagnostic Statistical Manual, because this is the same tool that mental health professionals work out of. So if you ever go to any sort of clinician, social worker, psychiatrist, primary care doctor, this is the book that guides the way they get paid and how they diagnose you as an individual. So you can ask for a copy of your mental health or your medical report, and this may be in it if you happen to be diagnosed with this generalized anxiety disorder. Now, there's a lot in this generalized anxiety disorder. It's not just simple. But for this show, The Empowerment Hour, we basically want to give you a reference so that you can get the overtone of how generalized anxiety affects you in your daily life. We're not going to strictly just be clinical in nature. We'll leave that up to your psychiatrist or your mental health professional to do that. But we want to get a personal feel. We want to do what this show is intended to do. We want to add a empowerment perspective to your daily and social life needs and experiences. Now, to determine if you might have an indicator of generalized anxiety, you might find it difficult to control your worrying. Anxiety and worry are associated with three or more of the following six symptoms. You see, we keep going back to that same word, symptoms. And these symptoms are present for more days than not for, again, 6 months. Now, these are for adults only right now. That's what we're focusing on, adults. Let's say you find yourself being restless, feeling keyed up or on the edge all the time. Now, mind you, this got to go on for 6 months before you meet the indicators for this disorder, mental health disorder. Restlessness. You might can't rest at night. You might lay down and your mind continually process where you can't get into that REM sleep where you can relax and get refreshed and reboot from, you know, all the stresses that you went through throughout the day. Because anytime you go to work and anytime people come to you with different scenarios of the day, it could be troubling, it could be exciting, but as a human, you need to reboot. Everything needs to be rebooted. Even your cell phone has to be cut off and regenerated so that it can work properly. You the same way. Your body needs to rest. But when you find yourself that you can't rest, that's one indicator. Now, when you find yourself being easily fatigued, now I'm not talking about when you go to the gym and you run or exercise for a substantial amount of time, maybe an hour, and you kind of wear your body out and you might say, I'm so tired, I just can't make it, and you rest. We talk about the lack to thrive, the motivation, where you haven't done an exercise or took any substance, and you just don't have that motivation to get up in the morning. Your lack of willpower, you know, to go. You feel lethargic in nature. You're feeling like an overwhelmingness of laziness. I just can't go today. I just don't feel like moving. That's a good indicator. That's fatigue. And when you find yourself difficult concentrating, or you find yourself with your mind going blank, you know how you have that stargazing, you're just looking off in the clouds, and someone asks you, hey, what are you thinking about, T.K. Smith? Oh, I don't know. I just was standing here. That's a blank thought. You know, it's not goal-oriented. You're not saying like I'm going in my bag and get my keys out of my keys and then I can unlock my door. There's a difference. What if you're just standing by your car and you're not going to get your keys and you never get in the car? That's a blank thought. Concentration is very poor at that stage. And if you find yourself doing that for 6 months or more, this is a good indicator that you might have a mental health situation that you need to get evaluated by your healthcare professional. And you find yourself irritable. Now, we all get irritable. I mean, I don't know a person in the world that don't wake up in the morning and say, I just don't want to be bothered today. Today is a rest day for me. I'm not talking about those days. I'm not talking about the reboot days. I'm not talking about the days where you could just relax and forget the world, as I call it. I'm talking about when you're next to a person and everything gets on your nerve. When people are talking to you and you just don't feel like talking. It seems like if anyone walk up to you, just pretty much got an attitude about everything. You know, your tone and your voice change, your facial construction change. Your whole demeanor is guarded. You have an angry affect. This is irritability. Now, mind you, these indicators must occur for 6 months or more to meet the DSM, Statistical Manual, indicator of anxiety disorder. Now, we don't want to think about, and we're not going to get too much into the medical part, because it's many people that worry about health. You know, you might have an onset of diabetes, and that could trigger anxiety, moments of anxiety, emotions of anxiety. You might use a substance that caused you to have anxiety and worry. You know, we're not talking about that. We're talking about no use of substance, no healthcare illness that has an onset that caused you to have general anxiety. We're talking about social, occupational issues at this time, because we want to give you just an overview. Now, anxiety and worry are physical symptoms causes clinical significant distress or impairment in social, occupational, or other important areas in your life. Maybe you worry so much you can't talk to your spouse or your mate, your significant other. That irritability has influenced everything that you do. Your fatigue has caused you to miss appointments, to visit family, and your restlessness. You can't even function throughout the day because you can't get a decent REM sleep pattern. Now, most of the time, like I said before, these psychological symptoms or effects are not contributed to drug abuse, medication, keep that in mind now, or some sort of medical condition, or a developmental disorder. So pretty much out of the Diagnostic Statistical Manual, this is what a clinician will quote you on after they find out the indicators fit a certain disorder and you receive the diagnosis. And we might say, how many people actually walk around or admit that they have generalized anxiety disorder? How do you know if you got it? How do you know? Maybe we don't talk about that in our family. Maybe we don't talk about it in our social circles, you know. But let's talk about a few facts of the day, okay? Generalized anxiety disorder is abbreviated as GAD, G-A-D, a condition characterized by 6 months or more of chronic, exaggerated worry and tension that is unfounded or much more severe than the normal anxiety most people experience. People with GAD usually expect the worst. Now, I'm reading this out of the medicinenet.com. And for those that would like to look this up, you can look this up on www.medtrms.com. And you can go under the category of generalized anxiety disorder, because on this show we match need to resources and give you that empowerment perspective to your issues. And this issue of the day is anxiety disorder. Well, let's get back to our article. Now, people with GAD usually expect the worst. They worry excessively about money. Oh man, they worry about health, family, work, and even when there's no signs of trouble. And say, there's nothing going on in your life, but you still constantly worry. It just feels like something is going wrong. What is it? Something has me on edge continuously, and it just doesn't feel right. It's been going on a while, and I haven't talked to anyone, and other people have noticed my change in behavior, but I haven't even, you know, sought help. When do I know to get help? See, we're going to get to that part. I want to keep you in tune, because we're going to talk about when is it time for you to determine that maybe you need to seek help. Because most people with mental health issues do not receive help until there's a crisis. You do not want to wait till you have a crisis to seek help. Because if you have a psychological breakdown, first of all, you're not in your mind to make logical decisions about your own health care. And we're going to talk about what happens when you get in a situation that you can't make decisions for yourself, and other people, you're dependent on other people to do that for you. Now, we have a number to call in if you'd like to call in. It's 813-235-0644. We even have an email at empowermenthour@yahoo.com if you want to communicate with the Empowerment Hour show, T. Caseman. Let's get back to GAD, okay? Most people are unable to relax and often suffer from insomnia. I mean, you just stay up all night. You can't rest. Most of the time, the source of your anxiety is hard to pinpoint. You can't even pick out one significant thing that'll cause you to worry, causing all this psychological stress in your life. Now, when you have excessive worry, based on medicinenet.com, you can have physical symptoms associated with too much stress and too much anxiety. You feel a fatigue, of course. You may tremble. You may have body trembles. Your muscles tensing up. You might experience headaches, irritability, and for some people, hot flashes. Yes, hot flashes. You may feel lightheaded. Sometimes you can even feel out of breath. These are a lot of symptoms that people suffer just because they're worried. Think about it, how your mind affects your body. It's very important. Sometimes you may even feel nauseated. You might even have to go to the bathroom more times than not. Frequently you might have to go to the bathroom more than normal. And you think it's other issues that causing you to go to the bathroom, but the restroom, but no, it's your mind. It's your thought pattern. Now, here's a fact for you. Nearly 3% of the adult U.S. population from ages 18 to 54 has generalized anxiety disorder during the course of a given year. Now, generalized anxiety usually the onset start in childhood or adolescence, according to medicinenet.com. So kids worry is just as much as adults. You know, I have heard the old saying that all you have to do as a child is to go to school and do your grades, and you don't have anything to worry about. Parents pretty much take care of all your needs. That's not so. Kids worry, too. They worry about their grades. They worry about their social connections. They worry about being liked by their friends. They worry about being the most popular dressed. They worry about sports. They worry about, you know, passing English or science, completing physical exercises. It's a lot. Personal appearances. Kids worry just as much as adults. So one need is not more than another. Because you can find many people that say, okay, my stress level is higher than yours because I have a hierarchy of need. Now, I got to pay rent. I got to provide for you. Parents will say, I need to cook and clean, and I must go to work. Now, we have a caller calling into the Empowerment Show. Hello, this is T. Caseman. You're on the Empowerment Hour. How can I help you today? Okay, we'll have our caller call back. If you're out there, caller, please feel free to call back again.
Caller, please call back again.
All right. Hello. This is T. Caseman. What's the pleasure you calling in today? I guess we lost our caller, but that's okay. We're here and we're patient and we're going to work this situation out. When we're talking about generalized anxiety disorder, and for those that want to call in again, it's 813-235-0644, and I'm your host, T. Caseman. Look forward to talking to you. Hello, caller. This is T. Caseman. Are you there?
T. Caseman?
Yes.
T. Caseman?
Yes.
Here, have them turn down their computer.
Can you turn down your computer, man? We're getting a lot of feedback on the show. If you turn down your computer, we'll be able to hear you more clearly.
T. Caseman?
Yes.
Hi.
My name is Yolanda. I'm a graduate student at the University of South Florida, and I have a question about anxiety disorder.
Oh, wonderful. If we can help you out, I look forward to it. Now, where are you calling from, Yolanda?
I am calling from Tampa, Florida. I'm currently on the campus of USF.
All right. Okay. Now, I just have to tell you that you can, you don't have to disclose any unique personal issues that you don't want to disclose to our audience, but you can speak in a general term if you, you know, feel embarrassed to do so. But what's your question today, Yolanda?
I'm trying to decide if I need to get some sort of assistance. I looked online. I saw that you have a graduate degree, so I'm sure you can understand some of my irritability, some of my frustrations, my mood changes, my inability to eat or sleep. And now lately, I've started to develop in some severe headaches, almost to the point where it feels like migraines. We're approaching graduation, and so, you know, we have a lot of papers to write and, you know, a lot of research to do and everything like that. But my symptoms have been coming on for about the last year or so.
Okay, so it's been over 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
I see.
And they're just gradually getting worse.
Okay, and these symptoms that you talk about is basically restlessness,
mm-hmm.
irritability.
Yes.
And you find yourself constantly worrying?
Yes, I'm worrying about if I'm going to pass this class, if I'm going to pass this class, if I'm going to pass this class, I'm not going to graduate.
I see. Now, first of all, that is a common worry amongst graduate students, because I found myself worrying a lot during those times of exams. But as you speak about earlier, that you found yourself over a period of time, and this is causing issues in your life. Do you feel like this worry is affecting other areas of your life?
Yes, it is, because I'm fighting more with my boyfriend, my parents. I just really don't want to talk to people because I'm so worried about my next step, graduation, what happens after graduation, trying to secure a job, and things of that nature.
Now, do you know if you had any type of family history of mental health?
Yes, sir. My mother suffered from mental health issues, depression, really badly, to the point where she has to take some sort of medication and also get some outside counseling therapy.
And as far as you know, it's just basically your mother, right, that had mental health or diagnosed with depression?
Yes.
Okay. And what is your true worry that scares you, those fears that scares you right now?
Fear of the future or of the unknown.
And you said the unknown. What is the unknown?
After graduation, am I going to find a job? Am I going to be financially secure if I just went through all of this and nothing's going to happen? Those type things.
I see. Now, have you ever talked to anyone in the... Have you ever talked to anyone about this situation? Have you sought any type of, professional help?
I would like to go and talk to someone, but since I'm a college student, I don't have any medical insurance, and I don't know where to go to seek any services.
Now, on your campus, usually there is a mental health site, and USF is known for their medical facilities. Now,
mm-hmm.
I'm not specific about what department you need to go to, but investigate in your USF directory if there is a mental health or counseling service on campus, because usually it is there and provided for you in your student fees.
Okay. I kind of don't want to go to an on-campus spot only because I have friends that are going into this field, and they do sometimes internships and stuff at the campus facilities. So do you know of any outside or away from campus facilities where I can go and maybe get some sort of counseling or even an assessment done?
Okay. All right. That's wonderful. In this Tampa area, we have a wide variety of resources, from healthcare to mental health. And if you, like yourself, Yolanda, you're saying that you don't want your colleagues or your peers to know, or even your professor to know that maybe you're dealing with some issues that you don't really want to share, or you might have a stigma of someone seeing you come out of the counseling center and you don't want to be labeled. I understand that fear. Now, in the local Tampa Bay area, there's a place called Mental Health Center.
Okay.
And these places are low cost, or even if you have some type of Medicaid, they can bill your Medicaid. Now, you can look that up online. You can look it in the local, look it up in the local Yellow Book, or you could dial 211 and find out what gets you at least three resources of mental health services in your area. And you could find out the fee. And you can actually set yourself up and schedule an evaluation to see if actually the source of your worry is causing dysfunction in your life. Now, mind you, your anxiety, your indicators that you spoke about earlier, the restlessness, the irritability, arguing with your partner, and isolating yourself. Now, these are all indicators of symptoms of some sort of dysfunction. The dysfunction is defined as, is it interrupting your academic and social life? And it sounds as though your social life is suffering right now.
Absolutely.
But I'm hoping that your academic is continuing to be successful.
Yes, the academic is fine. It's just socially, I just don't want to be bothered, or I'm irritated, or I'm in a bad mood, as my friends say all the time. Or if it's not those symptoms, then I'm just tired, like I just don't want to get out of bed, and I just have bad headaches all the time.
Well, definitely. There is quite a few resources out there to seek in your Tampa Bay area. And I have, Yolanda, I don't know if you have to go right now, but I don't have another call at the moment. But there is an assessment for anxiety and depression because that I did pull up as one of the resources, because here on the Empowerment Hour, we do like to match you need the resources. And I would like to just mention that symptoms can sometimes overlap. Because we was talking about general anxiety on this show, doesn't mean that, you know, it doesn't associate or connect or cross over with depression, because I heard you say that you have a family history of depression.
Yes.
All right. Now, depression is loss of interest in things that you like to do. Your appetite suffer. These are all symptoms of depression. Now, I'm not saying that you have depression, but your self-esteem may suffer. Or even at the worst extreme version, suicide thoughts. Okay? Now, generalized anxiety is agitation, dysphoria, sleep deprivation, fatigue, your concentration is lacking, and restlessness, irritability, and tension. And these they're very close and mimicking each other, and they're very close in shadowing other indicators. So your healthcare professional, when you do go seek help, write down on the list all the things that you're experiencing, how you sought treatment before in the past, and your family history, so that your healthcare professional or mental health professional can be more informed about how to help you. But for this show to help you, there's a generalized anxiety screening that you could find. And since you're a college student and graduate level, I want you to go to www.adaa.org. Now, this article speaks about Anxiety and Depression Association of America has put out this screening that you may give yourself. Print it out and give it to yourself. Take the test, and we'll go through it right now. And then you could take this to your counselor or during the evaluation, and it will help them to come up with a more accurate diagnosis. Now, here's the first one, okay? If you are troubled by the following, and you have to mark yes or no, you have excessive worrying occurring more days than not, for at least 6 months. See, you don't have to tell us what your results are on the show, but these, I just want you to listen to the self-screening that's out there for you at this site, at the Anxiety and Depression Association of America site. Unreasonable worry about events or activities such as work, school, or your health. Yes or no? The inability to control the worry. Yes or no? Now, the second category is, are you bothered by at least three of the following? Restlessness, feeling keyed up, or on edge frequently. Yes or no? Being easily tired. Yes or no? Problem concentrating. Yes or no? Irritability. Yes or no? Muscle tension. Yes or no? Trouble falling and staying asleep at night. Unsatisfied sleep. Yes or no? Your anxiety interfering with your daily life. Yes or no? Now, to continue with this assessment, you need to ask yourself, how many of these are scoring yes? How many of these are scoring no? These are all indicators on which avenue to take and how soon you need to seek treatment. Now, here's another category. Having more than one illness at the same time can make it difficult to diagnose and treat different conditions. Depression and substance abuse are among the conditions that occasionally complicate anxiety disorder. See, because like I said before, some of these indicators actually cross interface with each other. So let's ask yourself this question. Have you experienced change in your sleep or eating habits lately? Yes or no on the test, see, on the self-screening. More days than not, do you feel like this? Sad or depressed? Yes or no? Disinterested in life? Yes or no? Do you feel worthless or guilty? Yes or no? During the last year, has the use of alcohol or drugs resulted in your failure to fulfill responsibility with work, school, or family? Yes or no? And now we're close to the end of this self-screening. Now, have you gotten arrested because of your behaviors or your drinking? Yes or no? And do you have problems or cause problems with your loved ones? Yes or no? Now, taking a self-assessment of yourself, as this Anxiety Depression Associated of America self-screening survey says, and it's kind of leads you toward the way, what are you thinking about that self-assessment? What do you think about it?
Just without revealing too much confidentiality, I need to talk to a professional to help me figure out everything that's going on. But I will be honest with you and say, because you don't know me and you didn't see me anyway, but most of the symptoms, the fatigue, the headaches, the irritability, the inability to sleep and worrying about future bad moods and stuff like that, I definitely meet the criteria for generalized anxiety disorder just from what I've been listening to you saying. And I do need to get some assistance with that.
Well, wonderful. I hope that this show has enlightened you about certain social situations in your life that may lead you to seek the proper treatment. And if TK can never be assistance, please don't hesitate to email me at empowermenthour@yahoo.com or even feel free to call this show. We air every Wednesday at 7:30 to 8:30 p.m. And at this show, I take pride in talking to you and not at you. And I hope that I was able to help you.
Thank you, sir. Have a good evening.
Have a good evening. Now, we had a most enlightening caller that called in, and I would like to thank that caller, Yolanda, for calling in, because it takes a lot of courage to talk to someone about psychological issues or problems that you may face. Sometimes it's easy to talk to a stranger. So you should seek some type of counseling or even seek some sort of evaluation, even if you feel like your mental health is not causing major dysfunction in your life. I mean, what's wrong with going to the doctor and getting a regular physical checkup every once in a while, at least once a year? How many times people ask you, how many times this year have you had a mental health checkup? Well, let's talk about what type of treatment out there for you. Because like I, in the case with Yolanda, USF student, you know, this sounds like a common theme that happened across college campuses. Therapy techniques exist out there that can help you on many scales. And for all people that like to research, you can look it up. Cognitive behavior therapy, CBT, is one that causes people a lot of success. It's well established, highly effective, and it has lasting treatment. Cognitive behavior therapy focuses on identifying, understanding, and changing thinking and behavior patterns. So see, this is an option that when you go to your evaluation or you are sitting in front of your mental health practitioner, guide, you could be an active part of your own treatment and not passive. And that is the key. We want you to be active in your treatment. Exposure therapy is another form of therapy. It's another form of cognitive behavior therapy. And I am getting this information off Anxiety Depression Association of America website, and you could download it yourself for future reference at www.adaa.org. Exposure therapy, where the person is gradually exposed to a fear situation or object, learning to become less sensitive over time. Interpersonal therapy is another option. It's often referred to as IPT. Interpersonal therapy is a short-term supportive psychotherapy that addresses interpersonal issues in depression in adults, adolescents, or older adults. IPT usually involves 12 to 16 one-hour weekly sessions. The initial sessions are devoted to gathering information about the nature of the person's depression and interpersonal experience. Now, I want you to be active in your treatment because, like when you go to your physical doctor, you don't sit there passive. He asks you a few questions and you tell him symptoms or indicators if you have the flu or whatever, so he can give you a sort of treatment. I want you to be active in your mental health treatment. Now, let's take the hypothetical that stresses in your life get to a point where you can't make decisions for yourself. This is the point I want to drive home. Most people in healthcare has a advanced directive for medical situations. But what if you get Baker Acted? Baker Acted is usually the officer on charge determine if the police is called out that you're harm to yourself or others. And you can involuntarily be placed in institutional care for treatment and evaluation purposes for at least 72 hours, determined by the psychiatrist on duty. Now, what if you having a psychosis where you're not in a logical frame of mind and you need to make decisions for yourself? You need to seek a healthcare advanced directive. But there's one for mental health advanced directive. And this is not being passive. This is active. You can write out the instructions of what type of medications you think you ought to take, who should make the decisions, the phone number, what type of treatment you made in the past, and who you like to have visit you in the time of this distress. So now, you can find this directive at the www.nrc/pad.org site. And there's plenty questions and answers that you can find at the National Resource Center on Psychiatric Advanced Directives. And you can even specify by state on what's the legal laws, the limitations, and what all you can put in your psychiatric advanced directive. So these are all resources you can utilize. And there's question and answers on how Can I write a legal binding psychiatric advance directive? Can you even do that? Can I write instruction regarding my psychiatric medications or even hospitalization? If I become incompetent, can my agent make decisions for me about my medications or hospitalization? Can your agent that you specify make decisions on your behalf the way they see fit and not the way you determine? But I suggest always seek legal advice and professional help, because this show is only an overview and not to be construed as clinical expertise. T. Casemans is here to empower you and give you motivational perspective to unique social issues in your life. And today's lesson is anxiety disorder. Now, we're coming close to the end of the show, so we have any callers that need to call in and want to express how they feel about the show, you can call in at 813-235-0644, or you can email us at empowermenthour@yahoo.com. And usually after we give you a few resources, we like to give you a moment of catharsis. That's T. Casemans thought about daily life event, how my personal feels fit with people, and just my little point of view or my little tag on life. And you might not agree, you might agree. It might even apply to you, but it's T. Casemans that talks about these issues. Now, my moment of catharsis goes as thus. Life is dynamic in nature. There's no set time that anyone ever said, I probably won't experience divorce. I probably won't experience financial difficulty. I probably won't even experience any sort of mental health illness at all. Who would ever thought that I would lose my job that I worked so hard to get to? Who would ever thought that I rose to the level of graduate degree and didn't never finish school? Who would ever thought that I couldn't use my college education to further my career? As I called a call earlier, she has anxiety about her future, even if it's prominent. She has a thriving career in academic right now and on track for success and graduation. But as you see, she's still worried about anxiety. She has symptoms of anxiety about the future, like we all do. No one as a child ever said, I want to grow up and just learn how to worry. I want to grow up and I'll be addicted to drugs. I'll grow up and I'll just have a dysfunctional family. How many times you ever heard that? What are you inspired to be? Do I inspire to be homeless? Do I inspire to be in the low socioeconomic status? No one wakes up and say, I do not want to maximize my potential in life. Life will come at you hard and knock you down. And you need someone to talk to. Life is so dynamic that each and every phase of your life, you may need someone to help you make a transition from one stage to another. It could be as simple as, I'm having a baby and I don't know how to adjust. I'm getting married and I don't know how to separate single life to married life. It may be as simple as, I need to continue to grow as a person. But I want you to know here today that allow yourself to be great. Do not hold yourself back from these things. Learn and educate yourself about your issues. Take a self-assessment, learn what you need to do, find the resources, and seek that help. I'm your host, T. Casemans, and I look forward to talking to you and not at you. And the views of this show is only T. Casemans, and you should always seek and follow up with any advice that we give or any conversation or scenario of this show with a professional. Thank you, and I look forward to talking to you next time.